Tonight on NewsWatch, poverty on the rise. More people struggle to survive in today's harsh economy.
Plus, Taliban attack. The terrorist group hits the U.S. Embassy in Afghanistan.
And challenging the frontrunner, Rick Perry becomes the target of his fellow Republicans. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Things are getting worse for those hit hardest by the economy. Good evening, I'm Lee Webb.
And I'm Lori Johnson. The number of Americans living in poverty hits a 27-year high. The Census Bureau reports 15.1% of people fell below the line in 2010. That's more than 46 million people, or one in every six people. Unemployment is largely to blame. Joblessness has hovered at about 9% for 2 years as of tomorrow. Between 2007 and 2010, the poverty rate increased faster than any three-year period since the early 1980s. Mississippi has the highest percentage of poor people, with almost 23%. It is followed by Louisiana, the District of Columbia, and Georgia. One professor at the University of Chicago says the worst may be yet to come. Bruce Meyer believes the rising demand for food stamps is evidence things have gotten even worse this year.
And here to talk about the poverty rate in America is Robert Rector with the Heritage Foundation. Robert, thanks for being with us. I want to get some sort of understanding of what we mean by poverty. I think our minds automatically go to pictures that we see coming out of Sudan or somewhere. Is that what we're talking about when we define poverty in the United States?
Well, when you see a news story tonight on the other networks that says that there are 46 million poor people, you're going to have a picture of a homeless family. But only 1% of the poor in the United States are homeless. The typical poor child in the United States is far more likely to have cable TV, a computer, a widescreen plasma TV, and a TiVo system in his home than he is to be hungry. Only 4% of poor children were hungry at any point in the last year. We have great concern for those that are, but in fact, poverty in the United States does not mean homelessness or hunger.
What you studied, in fact, you're known by your colleagues as the intellectual godfather of welfare reform. What is the answer to this problem, however severe the problem may be?
Well, the reality is that the government spends close to $1 trillion a year assisting poor people and then doesn't count any of that spending as income when it calculates whether they're poor. It's ridiculous. But what we need to do is return to the words of Lyndon Johnson when he launched the war on poverty $17 trillion ago. He said he wanted to deal with the causes as well as the symptoms of poverty. If you want to do that, we have to rebuild the work ethic and we have to rebuild marriage, which is the principle, the loss of marriage is the principal cause of child poverty today.
And that doesn't sound like a job for the government, is it?
Well, the government penalizes marriage. It basically says to low-income couples through the welfare system, if you do get married, we're going to take your benefits away. We are spending, again, close to $1 trillion a year through a system that's indifferent or hostile to marriage, and that needs to be fixed.
No doubt there will be some political fallout. The administration is likely to point out, Robert, that the last time the poverty rate was this high was 1983. Of course, that was 2 years into Ronald Reagan's first term. What's your response to that?
Well, clearly, the recession has put a lot of people into hardship. We have huge levels of unemployment. But the fact is that census says that there are close to 40 million people in poverty every year. Good economic times are bad. And the reason it does that is because it basically doesn't count the welfare state when considering poverty. The fact of the matter is that poor families have air conditioning, cable TV, computers in the home. The home of the average poor American is larger than the home of the average Frenchman, not a poor Frenchman, but the average Frenchman. It's not poverty in the sense that people are ordinarily thinking about it.
Robert Rector with the Heritage Foundation. Robert, thank you for being with us and providing your insights.
Thank you.
President Obama believes his jobs plan will turn around the economy. He was on the road today selling his proposal, but it might be a tough sell to Republicans. Mr. Obama is calling for higher taxes to pay for his costly plan. Gary Lane has more.
The president sent a message to members of Congress Monday, saying they should act quickly to approve his jobs program.
And this is the bill that Congress needs to pass. No games, no politics, no delays.
Flanked by policemen, firefighters, and construction workers in the White House Rose Garden, Mr. Obama said his $447 billion jobs plan is a matter of priorities.
Do we keep tax loopholes for oil companies, or do we put teachers back to work?
But the president's jobs plan may face an uphill battle in the U.S. House of Representatives. Republicans are opposed to the tax hikes and tax changes proposed to fund the bill. Among items of contention, $405 billion by limiting charitable contributions and other deductions currently taken by Americans earning more than $200,000 per year, $41 billion by closing loopholes for oil and gas companies, and $18 billion by requiring fund managers to pay higher taxes on certain types of income. Speaking in South Carolina Monday, Republican presidential candidate Mitt Romney criticized the Obama plan, saying the president's ideas are outdated.
We're in a cell phone world now, and President Obama is continuing to pursue payphone policies, and we're in a smartphone world. His policies are not working. He keeps on jamming quarters into the payphone, not understanding why the economy doesn't get going again.
Gary Lane, CBN News.
The economic crisis in Europe could get worse, investors believing Greece may default on its debts. German Chancellor Angela Merkel is warning that a Greek default could spread throughout Europe. Some analysts say Europe could face a crisis similar to what the U.S. experienced in 2008. The Financial Times reports that Italy has turned to China for help with its debt problems. The Italian government hoping Beijing will buy a significant amount of government bonds and invest in key Italian companies.
All the Republican presidential candidates took to the stage last night for a debate in Tampa. But much of the attention and strong words went to the new front runner in the race, Texas Governor Rick Perry. Chief political correspondent David Brody has a wrap up from Florida.
The Social Security tag team match moved into round two in Tampa, with the two Republican frontrunners picking up where they left off. Rick Perry calls Social Security a fraudulent Ponzi scheme. His chief rival, Mitt Romney, is planting doubts that Perry might want to eliminate it.
The term Ponzi scheme is what scared seniors, number one. And number two, suggesting that Social Security should no longer be a federal program and return to the states is unconstitutional.
The people who are on Social Security today need to understand something. Slam dunk guaranteed, that program is going to be there.
The other GOP candidates were then asked to enter the entitlement ring.
I'm not particularly worried about Governor Perry and Governor Romney frightening the American people when President Obama scares them every single day.
Are you with Governor Romney or Governor Perry?
Well, the question is, who's with me?
I don't care what you call it. It's broken.
All I know, Wolf, is that we're frightening the American people who just want solutions.
Another contentious moment between Perry and Romney came over job creation.
I think Governor Perry would agree with me that if you dealt four aces, that doesn't make you necessarily a great poker player.
Mitch, you were doing pretty good till you got to talking poker. But the fact is, the state of Texas has led the nation.
Does your governor deserve all that credit?
Not quite.
Michelle Bachmann and Rick Santorum aggressively teamed up against the Texas governor for requiring the government to vaccinate 11-year-old girls against a sexual transmitted disease known to cause cancer.
To have innocent little 12-year-old girls be forced to have a government injection through an executive order is just flat out wrong.
This is big government run amok. It is bad policy, and it should not have been done.
I will tell you that I made a mistake by not going to the legislature first.
Then Bachmann questioned Perry over his ties to the vaccine maker, Merck.
The governor's former chief of staff was the chief lobbyist for this drug company.
It was a $5,000 contribution that I had received from them. I raise about $30 million. And if you're saying that I can be bought for $5,000, I'm offended.
Well, I'm offended for all the little girls and the parents that didn't have a choice. That's what I'm offended for.
Earlier in the day, Tea Party groups made it clear what they're looking for in a candidate.
We're looking for a leader that has courage, conviction, principles, and will stand up for the Constitution of the United States and will declare our freedoms again.
The fact that this debate was sponsored and shaped by a huge Tea Party group like the Tea Party Express shows just how far the Tea Party has come in shaping the political discourse in this country. Now we watch these Republican candidates and see how far they'll go to court favor with the Tea Party. David Brody, CBN News, in Tampa, Florida.
Dr. Paul Ponticelli joins us for his analysis of the Republican debate. He was appointed by President George W. Bush to a position at the U.S. Agency for International Development and now serves as Executive Vice President of Regent University. Thanks so much for joining us. So, last night, who won, who lost? Who had a good night and who had a bad night?
The better way to put it probably is good night and bad night. I think the governors had good nights. Both of them were very aggressive. They were strong. You could say that Rick Perry got the shorter end of it because he was attacked so much, but I think in the end that feeds into his support because he was firm. He apologized for a mistake he made. He's one of only two candidates that have done that actually said, I did something wrong. I wish I'd done it differently. The other was Governor Pawlenty, who's out of the race now. And Governor Romney looked very strong as well. He looks weaker when he's trying to defend Romney Care, as his critics call it. But I think the governors looked the best. I think the ones that didn't look so good are Michelle Bachmann and Rick Santorum because they had to be fairly strident. Mm-hmm. And that was the only way to get attention, which is what they need.
Now, the attacks were definitely on Rick Perry, and you felt like he fended them off pretty well?
I think that this debate, he seemed to hesitate more than he did the first one. Probably took him off guard, and I can imagine, you know, you have four or five people attacking you most of the night. I think he did show a little hesitation, but as to the substance of his policies and what he's done, he did not back off, and I think that showed strength to the Tea Party especially.
Now, we remember Ronald Reagan so famously said his commandment, thou shalt not speak ill of a fellow Republican. And we've seen that commandment broken, if you will. Right. How do you think that's going to affect the candidates in the general election?
At this point, I don't think it hurts because I don't think the issue of a Gardasil, the vaccinations, is really going to last as one that hurts Perry if he is the nominee. Romney could be hurt more if he becomes the front runner again and the issue is health care over and over and over. It'll make him weaker against President Obama, I think.
Now, when you talked again about Romney Care, do you think that this is going to be his Achilles heel in the primary?
I think it will continue to be an issue. I think it's hard to say if it's really going to be that big of an issue, but it will always be something he'll have to talk about, primarily, I think, because he's not really said, I didn't do the right thing. He's not been convincing with any kind of an apology, but standing firm for a principle behind it.
All right. Dr. Paul Ponticelli, thanks for your thoughts. Very interesting.
My pleasure.
Coming up, show of strength. The Taliban hits the U.S. Embassy in the heart of Afghanistan.
7 Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow. Sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling. Inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
If you're an individual, group, or business needing a dental plan, Avia Dental offers group plans for as little as $5 per month. Now members of your group can save up to 50% or more off a high-quality dental care. Everyone qualifies, and there's no waiting or limits on visits to the dentist. Visit aviadental.com or call 1-888-431-CARE. Avia Dental since 1994. Smile, you're with people who care.
7 Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow. Sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling. Inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
I'm Sylvia, and I am an alcoholic. My addiction made me feel dead inside. I am full of joy. I was so lucky to pick Hemet Valley Recovery Center to come, where there were people who understood me. And that's very special.
Hemet Valley Recovery Center and Sage Retreat. Take the first step.
Taliban fighters in Afghanistan fired on the U.S. Embassy and NATO headquarters in Kabul today. The assault came just 2 days after Americans commemorated 9/11.
And as John Waghi explains, 10 years after U.S. troops went into Afghanistan, the Taliban is showing its strength.
The coordinated attack came from a construction site just 1,000 feet from the embassy and nearby NATO headquarters. For several hours, the Taliban fighters shot rocket-propelled grenades and automatic weapons toward the embassy, creating chaos in the capital. At least four Afghans were wounded, but no one from the embassy or NATO.
We will take all necessary steps, not only to ensure the safety of our people, but to secure the area and to ensure that those who perpetrated this attack are dealt with.
The attack came just 3 days after the Taliban set off a truck bomb, wounding 77 American soldiers. More reminders that the Taliban's deep roots in the country enable it to strike just about anywhere. The U.S. and NATO are trying to train the Afghan army to secure the country. President Obama has said U.S. troops will be out of Afghanistan by 2014. NATO's top leader says the military transition from Western fighting forces to an Afghan-led mission is still on track.
We have confidence in the Afghan authorities' ability to deal with this situation. We are witnessing that the Taliban try to test transition, but they can't stop it. Transition is on track, and it will continue.
While some soldiers prepare to leave Afghanistan, these National Guard firefighters from Connecticut are saying goodbye to loved ones. They've been helping flood victims from Hurricane Irene and other natural disasters, but they'll soon be on their first one-year deployment to Afghanistan. Justin Herlick will miss his six-year-old daughter, Nina.
Pretty much I've been helping out people out there in the country. It'll go by fast, but it's just like a school year.
We've done smaller missions for the state, you know, emergency storms recently and stuff like that, but this is a full year of 24/7, 365 days, no time off, all firefighting. So it's a good experience for everyone.
John Waghi, CBN News.
Turkish Prime Minister Erdogan is in Cairo, Egypt, as part of his Arab Spring tour. It's the first visit of a Turkish leader to Egypt in 15 years. He says he believes the Mavi Marmara incident last year, when Israeli commandos boarded a Turkish ship bound for the Gaza Strip, was a cause for war. CBN News spoke with Mark Regev, the spokesman for Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, for his reaction.
We have seen, unfortunately, over the last few months, and maybe even a bit longer, this negative momentum in the relationship. It's not a good thing. From our perspective, we'd like to see the relationship between Jerusalem and Ankara be more positive. We hope that is the attitude of the Turkish government, that it is possible to turn things around.
The Obama administration is closely watching the situation developing between Israel, Turkey, and Egypt. It's troubled over the deterioration of relations with Israel and two countries that had been close allies.
Iran says it will release two American hikers being held on spy charges. Josh Vital and Shane Bowers' bail is set at $500,000 apiece. NBC News reports that Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad announced during an interview with NBC that he would free the hikers. Bauer and Vital were arrested more than 2 years ago. In an August trial, the men were sentenced to 8 years in prison.
Forces continue to persecute religious people in almost every corner of the earth. Today, the State Department shone a spotlight on the worst offenders. Paul Strand was there.
Hillary Clinton came before the news media to explain religious freedom and rights are still a top concern of the United States. And describing a new atrocity this week, she pointed out religious persecution goes on right till today.
Gunmen, masquerading as security officers, waylaid a bus of Shia pilgrims traveling throughout western Iraq. The women were abandoned by the side of the road, but the 22 men were shot and their bodies left in the middle of the desert.
The usual suspects still top the list of worst persecutors: Iran, North Korea, China, Burma, Saudi Arabia, Sudan, Eritrea, Uzbekistan. Some in government believe as secularism rises, much of this need to worry about religion will fade. But Reverend Rob Schenck of Faith and Action was at the State Department to say just the opposite is true.
The world is becoming more religious. Every religious group, and particularly conservative, strict religious groups, are booming exponentially. The future of the world is a religious one. It makes all of the religious components of our diplomacy, of our government, of our international relations, not just very important, but I would argue the most important thing that we do.
America's newest ambassador for religious freedom said the U.S. will keep the heat on whenever and however it can.
Too many countries in the world today do not allow people to exercise their religious freedom, or they make it difficult or dangerous to do so. So as hard as it may be, we need to get up every day and keep trying to make a difference.
Paul Strand, CBN News, the State Department.
Up next, one state says it will put the future of same-sex marriage in the hands of its voters.
7 Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow, sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
Would you like beautiful, flawless-looking skin under your eyes? Now you can get the plastic surgeon's secret to erasing the appearance of dark circles, puffiness, and bags under your eyes. Introducing Lumitone, your secret weapon to erase years from your appearance that works on all skin tones and types.
My patients who use Lumitone see a decrease in the appearance of dark circles, puffiness, and bags underneath their eyes, and it works instantly.
So how much would you pay to never look tired again? $100, $200, $500? If you call in the next 3 minutes, you can try Lumitone at home for free. Just pay the low shipping and handling of $5.99.
You see a big difference immediately. It's definitely a little magic in the bottle that I was hoping for. I love it.
So, if you'd like to go from this to this, call or go to Lumitone.com within the next 3 minutes to try Lumitone for free. Supplies are extremely limited, so don't delay. Call now.
7 Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow. Sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it. Trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
Voters in North Carolina will decide the fate of same-sex marriage. As George Thomas reports tonight, the state house there wants voters to decide on a constitutional gay marriage ban.
After much debate, North Carolina voters are one step closer to defining marriage. The state already has a ban on gay marriage, but it's not in their state constitution. So supporters of this bill say a constitutional amendment would make the ban stronger.
We're saying, allow us to vote on this to keep marriage the way the God of the Bible intended it to be. If the voters don't want it, then they'll vote it down. But I do believe, and we're prepared to live with that, but I do believe that the people's voice in a democracy should be heard.
Opponents of the ban say that this will be the first time a state amendment actually restricts people's rights.
We should be able to do what we want. We're in America. We should be able to feel how we feel, and they shouldn't be able to limit that.
I think this is a terribly sad day in our state, and will have repercussions for a long time if this amendment passes.
The bill is now headed for debate in the Senate, and if passed, the amendment will be voted on in May of 2012 during the primary elections. North Carolina House Speaker Tom Tillis says it's being kept off the November 2012 ballot to remove politics from the issue. 30 states have gay marriage bans in their constitutions. North Carolina is the only state in the Southeast without one. George Thomas, CBN News.
Up next, a soldier finds out it's good to be back home again for more reasons than she even knew.
Seven Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow, sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
John Mapes is 42. Yeah. Mortgage, married, two great kids. He wants to protect his family with a $500,000 term life insurance policy. What do you think it'll cost him? $100 a month? $60? $40? Actually, none of the above. John can get a $500,000 policy from a highly rated insurer for under $25 a month. His secret? SelectQuote. SelectQuote is impartial. They'll search the pick of insurers like these to give you a choice of your best prices. SelectQuote has great savings on term life for women, too. John's wife, Carrie, can get a $500,000 policy for under $16 a month. SelectQuote has helped make term life insurance affordable for hundreds of thousands of people since 1985. How about you? Just call this number or visit SelectQuote.com.
7 Days in Utopia is the number one Christian film in America.
Wow, sure is beautiful.
See the movie critics are calling inspiring, beautiful, charming, and wholesome.
First, you have to see it, feel it, trust it.
A must-see for Christians.
I think some time here might do you good.
Movies don't get much better than this.
I don't think that you're coming here for an accident.
7 Days in Utopia, the film that's transforming lives nationwide. Rated G. See it today.
Returning home from a combat deployment in Iraq or Afghanistan is always exciting for American service members.
Many times, families gather at the airport to welcome their loved ones home. Well, recently, one Indiana soldier got more than a warm welcome when she stepped off the plane. She got a marriage proposal. Indiana Guard Sergeant Jesse Fordyce brought a lot of support with him to the airport, and he made a sign with a proposal message. And when his girlfriend and fellow soldier, Kelly Osborne, came down the stairs, they held up the banner, and Jesse got down on one knee.
She did say yes. Numerous times.
I think before yes. I'm shocked.
It's very, very exciting. She's found a wonderful man, and we're very excited.
They've given so much, you know, to our country and to all of us, and we've all seen him go through so much when Jesse was injured and everything, and Kelly's just a great soldier, too, and I just couldn't be happier for both of them.
That's great.
Jesse, an Iraq veteran and Purple Heart recipient, says he is relieved she said yes and is happy they're now engaged. The couple hope to set a date and get married within the next 6 months.
That's a great story. We've done a lot of these homecoming stories, but that's the first one we've done where proposal. Right. My son returned home from Iraq a year ago. He waited a few months to ask his fiancée to marry him, but she said yes to
Wonderful. Why wouldn't she?
Yeah.
Well, thanks for joining us for this edition of NewsWatch.
Good night.